Goedenavond en welkom bij die wekelijkse keur van interessante journaalbijdragen. Tonight, Encore features something old and something new. The film Jurassic Park creates a dinosauric interest among young people. Die klein karoo spoort deesdae met sy eie wyn. Work's being done to help non-English speakers acquire language skills. Die kunst van papyrus herleef weer. During the last few months, we've been inundated by media hysteria and commercial spin-offs generated by the film Jurassic Park. The real stars of the story are, of course, the dinosaurs, who have captured the imagination of millions, especially children, around the world. Here in South Africa, we have the remains of dinosaurs which predate the movie monsters of Jurassic Park. We bring you an excerpt from a program originally broadcast on 50/50, when the boys from St. Stivians were hot on the trail of these long extinct creatures.
The remains of this dinosaur have been found in Southern Africa, and findings are especially common in areas of the Free State and Northern Cape. But it was here in the Free State that our adventure began. We linked up with a group of Standard 4s from St. Stivians Prep School in search of our own Triassic monster. We had expert help in the form of geologist and paleontological consultant Gideon Groenewald. He suggested that the boys start their quest in the Golden Gate area near Clarence.
A creamy one in the middle and a black one on top. In South Africa,
it was here that they studied the layers of rock on the lookout for clues. Rocks are like the pages of a history book. They have a story to tell if you know where to look.
In South Africa. Now, if you look at the crowns behind us, you will see that we have two definite layers of rock. We have a lower one that falls apart very obviously. You can see it's just very brittle, falling apart. And then we have another one much more resistant on top. And then there's a third funny thing in this road cutting.
The red rock indicates a time when the area was covered with lakes. And the yellow stone above occurred when the desert took over the region. The Jurassic dinosaurs were, however, evolving in America and Europe. Evidence of this episode is to be found in the thick lava deposits of the Drakensberg and in the mountains here at Golden Gate. Massospondylus, which means massive spine, was an egg-laying creature. Gideon was able to show the boys the spot where eggs, complete with embryos, had been discovered in this cutting by well-known paleontologist James Kitching.
That was already in the 1976, he found the first ones. And he found, I think he told me, he found up to four or five nests in this specific area. And this is what they look like. It's not that impressive, but inside these eggs, you find these little pieces of bone, and that is the embryos of the dinosaurs that actually, the eggs were half hatched, and then they just killed off. They were killed off by some reason. I think it's because it became so dry that the eggs lost their moisture, and the dinosaurs, the little chicks, then died because of that. And they were all petrified and all became rock with their mothers and the rest of the dinosaurs.
This Jurassic raptor and the Tyrannosaurus rex may be impressive, but Gideon's reptilian and dinosaur fossils are older and in a sense more important than those found in the Jurassic period.
Now looking at the Jurassic Park flick, we had the reconstruction of some of the fossils found in America. Now those animals are of a different age. They are from ages younger geologically than the ones that we find in South Africa. And they are therefore Jurassic and Cretaceous.
The finds in the Clarence area look set to spark a commercial venture, a dinosaur park. Parks such as this one at Münchenhagen in Germany serve to stimulate interest in the past. This model of Tyrannosaurus rex really caught the lads' attention here at Golden View, where a similar venture to the one in Germany is underway. The lads were back on the job on day two when the weather lifted, and they were able to continue with their search.
Okay, now we follow the little stream where we found all these little bits and pieces, right?
Oh, look at this.
Look at this thing here. My goodness, this is fantastic. Just look at this thing here, okay? Now, if we look carefully, you will see a lot of red material lying around. And you've got one there. This here, it's actually all part of this animal. It's all parts of the bones.
Yes.
Okay, there's one there. There's a whole lot here. There's some sticking out here. There's a massive bone coming out here. You see the bone coming out there? There's another one coming out here. Can anybody else spot another bone? I'm now looking at this. Maybe there's a bone.
There's one there.
Yes. Now look at this yam. Okay, this might be the femur going around. So we'll have to open up from there all the way to there to see what actually comes out here now. You see, it's all broken. The green in the color of the soil indicate that this was a pond of water that never dried out. And that's why this animal, well, it never dried out until this poor animal drank for its last drink here. So we've got two layers now. We've got the claw coming in, and then we've got part of the body still overlying that now. Because this animal probably died with its feet in like this. So the body bones and the foot bones are all mixed, which now makes the excavation of this animal very complicated. Well, so you all realize now all the bones are now mixed up, one on top of the other. Then the paleontologists will, once it's exposed completely, they will then, in theory, pull all the bones apart and fit them right back in so that they have the correct form of the animal right in the end.
In the film Jurassic Park, it said that from mosquitoes you could get the blood and DNA of dinosaurs and then recreate dinosaurs. Is this possible?
I suppose it's possible to get DNA, dinosaur DNA, from dinosaur bones. In fact, I've recently heard that they have actually isolated dinosaur DNA. But that's a long way from getting a dinosaur, because you've only got one molecule. Whether you can make a dinosaur from one DNA molecule, that I don't know.
Perhaps Jurassic Park 2 will have the answer to that. Already, paleontologists in the Henan province in China have unearthed several caches of dinosaur eggs and are researching the possibility of getting DNA from these eggs. Who knows what the future holds?
Fascinating. If you'd like to get to grips with some dinosaur bones, the Bernard Price Institute of Paleontology will be holding an exhibition at the Sanlam Center in Randburg tomorrow. Nou gesels ons oor wyn. Kom ontmoet vir Sweepie en Anne Leroux van die ou familieplaas Domein Doornkraal in die Klein Karoo naby De Rust. Hierdie egpaar spog nie net met 6 mooi dogters nie, maar is deesdae baie trots op hulle heerlike landgoedwyn wat op ons Suid-Afrikaanse wynkaarte prik.
Hierdie is 'n wêreld van ruimte en van uiterstes, wat meestal met skape en volstruise geassosieer word, nie juis met wyn nie. Behalwe miskien as 'n mens daaraan dink dat die Klein Karoo 'n spesiale soort dors veroorsaak. Maar van volstruise kind gepraat, baie van ons ken Oudtshoorn se wêreld vir daardie spoggerige dae van die volstruisveer era. Dit was gedurende die vroeë deel van die eeu, toe kasteelagtige huise met hul spitstoringdakke en uitspattige broekielys traliewerk soos absurde veepaleise oral op die vaal landskap verrys het. Ongelukkig net so vinnig as wat die mode vir daardie vere van hierdie eienaardige kreature gekom het, so het dit gekwyn. En baie van die volstruispaleise het in verwaarlosing verval. Die geharde mense van hierdie wêreld is toe gedwing om nuwe planne te beraam en hul ingebore vindingrykheid en kreatiwiteit in te span. Die plaasbedrywighede is baie oulik gediversifiseer en vandag, sy aan sy met die volstruis en skaapboerdery, staan pragtige wingerde wat uit die lopende en unieke wyne voortbring. Al name en etikette weerspieël hul eienaars se eie soortige humorsin en oorspronklikheid. Geleë naby die dorpie De Rust in die voetheuwels van die Swartbergreeks naby Oudtshoorn, lê die plaas Doornkraal waar die Leroux-familie reeds 4 geslagte lank die grond bewerk en ontgin. Tans aan die roer van sake is die innemende en flamboyante Gerrit Leroux, alom bekend as Sweepie. Hierdie kleurvolle gemeenskapsleier en innoveerder het die plaas van sy vader, die voormalige minister van Landbou en Waterwese, meneer P.K. Leroux, geërf. Typies van sy vernuwende benadering, bemark hy sy wyne vandag onder die naam Domein Doringkraal en wyname soos Kanaland, Serenade, Kuierwyn en Kwaaiman is enkele van sy ware inspirasies. Met die snel groeiende bedrywighede en sweepiese onuitputtelike idees was die tyd uiters geleë toe sy enigste seun Piet onlangs van studies terugkeer om sy kant by die wynverbouing te bring. Domein Doringkraal se nuwe geslag Merlot rooiwyn is 'n uitvloeisel van sy invloed. Die lesse van die verlede word egter nie afgeskryf op hierdie plaas nie.
Dis die Klein Karoo, so jy is gemengde boerdery. Hy is so gemeng dat jy kan baie maklik die fout maak om te veel goed mee te wil boer. Maar hoofsaaklik is dit wingerd en volstruise. Daar's dit groentesade, eie en wortels. Tabak as ons water het. Maar kyk, tabak en wingerd kompeteer vir dieselfde bietjie water wat jy het in die somer. So jy moet kyk as jy genoeg water het in jy tabak plant. En dan is het lucern en dit is angora bokken, boerbokken, een bietjie skaap. En uitgedacht pere wat ons steel. Mense wil die goed op ons geniet hê. Maar dit is omtrent die som totaal.
As die dag se bedrywighede afgehandel is, dan is Sweepie gelukkig genoeg om huiswaarts te keer na een van daardie formidabele verepaleise. Dit was gebou deur sy grootvader Gert. Hierdie monument vir 'n glorieryke verlede is waar Sweepie en sy vrou Ernel 6 dogters en 1 seun grootgemaak het en hul eie wynkultuur ontwikkel het.
Op universiteit het ek hom ontmoet, hierdie vreeslike, ek het gedink is 'n baie handsome ouetjie. En hy, sy pa was 'n parlementslid, het toe hoofsweep geword van die nasionale party. En toe hy ontgroen word, moes hy rondloop en sê, my pa is 'n groot sweep en ek is 'n klein sweepie.
Een van die paartjie se gesamentlike projekte is die sogenaamde wynhuis langs die groot pad tussen Oudtshoorn en die Meyringspoort. Hulle het 'n verspreidingspunt vir hul wyne nodig gehad, want die produkte word alles onder eie etiket bemark. Miskien is die kleurvolste en opvallendste van hierdie wyne die vrolike semi-soet blanc de noir vonkelwyn Tickle Pink met sy pink volstruisbeer.
Jy weet, dit is so lekker om vrolik te wees met wyn. Maar die volstruis het dit vir ons moontlik gemaak in die Klein Karoo om die om wyn te produseer en om dit te bemark. En ons is baie verskuldig aan die volstruis in die Klein Karoo. En dit is hoekom ek besluit het, daar moet 'n volstruismotief wees. As hier 'n jong paartjie inkom, koop 'n bottel Tickle Pink met 'n veer. Maar julle mag net die veer gebruik om mee te kielie. Die ander een is, as hier 'n ouerige paar inkom, dan verkoop ons hom met 'n stofretjie. Dit sodat die nuwe vrou nou maar die spinrakker kan afstof daarmee.
Wat wou Sweepie, 'n mens is nooit te oud om te kielie nie. Nou hierdie bydra was die tweede in 'n reeks wat saterdaoggende op GMSA uitgesaai word. Moet dit nie misloop nie.
Until recently, the Department of Education and Training's policy at black schools has been to instruct the mother tongue for the first 4 years of schooling. Under this system, a great number of children have had very little exposure to English. A change is now being implemented, and parents may choose the medium of instruction for their children. The Christian Brothers College in Cape Town has anticipated the need for English and decided to help. Apart from enriching their lives and helping them to get somewhere in school, it also builds bridges between South African children.
Through the dedicated fundraising efforts of the Parents Association at Christian Brothers College in Greenpoint, Cape, a modern and well-equipped computer center started operating in 1991, where language, mathematics, typing, and computer literacy were taught. Despite the fact that the opportunity has finally arisen for black pupils to enroll in English medium schools, the children have great difficulty in doing so because of their lack of fluency in English. CBC identified the need and did something about it.
Very soon after our computer network was installed about 2.5 years ago, we realized that we had an enormous resource here that we were at least able to share with the local community. And so we investigated the backgrounds of a number of schools and identified Zamasa Primary in Langa as a suitable school, and their teachers were so enthusiastic. Zamasa Primary is a long way from Greenpoint, And to get them here, we have to rely heavily on corporate sponsorship. And through a local bus company, we bus in 120 a week, 60 on a Tuesday and 60 on a Wednesday. And when the group of 60 arrives here on one of those days, that group is split into two. 30 would go into the computer room, and 30 for a language module, a conversation module in the classroom.
Right, now I'm going to explain once more so that you know exactly what we're going to do. Today, we are going to learn about the clothes that we wear, all the things that we put on.
The CBC English Outreach Programme presented a great challenge. After an initial written test to ascertain the general standard of English used by the Zamaza pupils, a program was drawn up concentrating on basic vocabulary, phonics and spelling, sentence construction, word order and parts of speech. All this has been taught through discussions, games, stories, group work and demonstrations. Mr. Jengeli, principal of Zamaza, says not only does the program provide and develop linguistic skills, but builds cultural and racial bridges, and he applauds CBC for embarking on such a project.
I also see this program as a project which addresses the imbalances that have been created by the apartheid education, because for the first time our children are exposed to technology. In that way, they are acquiring technological skills which their parents were deprived by the system.
When the children get there in the afternoons, we divide them into two groups. The one group goes into the computer room, the other group goes into the classroom, because we realize that using the computer only wouldn't be enough. We want them to do some oral work and some written work as well, and then we try to link it. For example, in the computer room, we have a program, for example, that where they do nursery rhymes. They have to complete the nursery rhymes. Now, we realized quickly that the children all didn't understand the nursery rhymes, or they didn't know it. So what we did was we took it into the classroom, we explained it to them, we got them to act it out, then we took them back into the computer room, and we had broad smiles all over because suddenly they understood much better and they could do it. We also, for instance, get in the classroom when they have a list of things, list of words that they have to study, and they struggle with that, we would take that up to the computer room, and we would then put it onto the computer where they have sound and color, and it's much more exciting for them to learn it.
Susie loves these classes.
I learn how to speak English, and I learn to use computer, and in computer I learn more games, and we read books, and these books help me with my vocabulary.
And the children are not the only ones who benefit from the outreach. Each week the teachers come along as well to keep up with technology and the development of the pupils.
I'm learning together with them. I'm learning about how to operate computer. I never did it until I came here.
The project has drawn tremendous appreciation from pupils, parents and staff in the black community. CBC is proud they are able to contribute something towards building a new South Africa with equal education opportunities.
Ek wens skool gaan was so lekker in my dae. Nou vanaand bied ons u nog 'n interessante bydrae uit Egipte aan. Die Egiptenare is bekend vir hulle fyn handewerk. Die maak van papier uit papirus is 'n groot aantreklikheid vir toeriste. Hierdie veselplant wat oorspronklik in die Nyl-delta voorgekom het, was die voorloper van vandag se papier.
Papyrus grows in Lower Egypt because it needs lots of water as well as moderate weather. The papyrus plant was sacred for the ancient Egyptians for two main reasons. The first one, because of the shape of the plant itself. It looks like the rays of the sun, which was a sacred god for the ancient Egyptians, the sun god Ra. The second reason, because of the stem itself, looks like a triangle, which is the shape of the pyramid. It does represent eternity.
Dit is moeilik om eens in te dink waar die wêreld vandag sou gewees het sonder die papyrusplant. Papier was immers die vervoermiddel van beskawing en moderne ontwikkeling sou sonder dit beslis heel wat stadiger plaasgevind het.
The ancient Egyptians had discovered how to make those papers thousands of years ago, before even the Chinese. And the secret of making the papers was lost for so many hundreds of years. The first time to rediscover how the papers were made, it's only 30 years ago.
Vandag word hierdie antieke metode noukeurig gevolg om papyrus mee te maak. Nadat die papyrus stingel gesny en fyn gerol is, word dit in water geweek. Daarna word dit kruis en dwars oor mekaar gelê, voordat dit onder 'n swaar gewig vasgedruk word. En wanneer dit onder die parser uitkom, is dit 'n vel papyrus wat verbasend sterk is. Hierna kom die kunstenaars aan die beurt wat antieke Egiptiese simbole en gode hierop verf. Dit kos fyn werk om al die detail aan te bring en so handgeverfde papyrus neem sowat 'n week om te voltooi. Kopers by die verskeie papyrusgalerye in Egipte kan dan ook hulle name in hieroglife hierop laat verf. En na al die werk is die eindresultaat iets besonders. Nog 'n kuns waarvoor die Egiptenare bekend is, is die weef van matte. By hierdie fabriek in Kaïro word matte van suiwer sy, wol en kameelhare met die hand geweef. En dis 'n tegniek wat reeds op 'n vroeë ouderdom deur kinders bemeester word. Toeriste is soms bekommerd oor die jong ouderdomme van die kinders. Maar die fabriek is 'n soort koshuis waar die kinders tuis gaan en werksure word volgens die wet bepaal.
It's legal because it's kind of education for them. They first start learning and after 10 years of learning they become professionals and this is a career for them. But now we teach them how to make the carpet and also we teach them reading and writing beside it. The processing is very complicated and for the children they understand how to make the carpets and follow the patterns very easy.
En die eindresultaat is versamelstukke wat mens eerder teen 'n muur hang. Daar is drie kategorieë. Die eerste word van kameelhare geweef en geen spesifieke patrone word gebruik nie. Die matte kan enige toneel uitbeeld en dit neem sowat 'n week tot 10 dae om 1 vierkante meter te weef. Die tweede kategorie is wolmatte wat soos die sy-matte geknoop word. Daar is 49 knope per vierkante sentimeter en dit neem tussen 1 en 2 maande om 'n vierkante meter te voltooi. Die ontwerpe op die matte is islamities, antiek of kopties. Die laaste en belangrikste kategorie is die matte van suiwer Egiptiese sy. Daar is tussen 81 en 100 knope per vierkante sentimeter en dit neem sowat 4 maande om 1 vierkante meter te maak. Om te toets of die matte van suiwer sy is, kan mens dit ronddraai. Die kleure sal ligter en donkerder word. Maar by die meeste winkels is so toets onnodig, want hier word net die beste kwaliteit verkoop en toeriste kan sonder enige voorbehoude hulle handgemaakte Egiptiese aandenkings vir baie jare tuis gaan geniet.
Isabel Verwy het hierdie interessante reeks oor Egipte vir Goeiemôre Suid-Afrika en 6-op-1 saamgestel. Nou vroeër vanjaar het Encore 'n program uitgesaai oor Tsabo en Violet, die twee sjimpansees wat na Zambië geneem is, nadat hulle onwettig in Suid-Afrika ingebring is. Die voorsitter van die organisasie Friends of Chimpunji, Steve Thompson, was 2 maande gelede op Chimpunji waar hy met 'n tuisvideo 'n klompie opnames van die sjimpansees gemaak het. Al is die kwaliteit nie so goed nie, wys ons u graag hoe dit nou met die toetjies gaan.
In die vorige program het ons gewys hoe Sabo en Violet by Chimpunji aangekom het, waar Pieter en Sheila Siddel nou al 42 sjimpansees versorg. Die twee is nou deel van 'n groep van 5 klein chimpansees wat elke dag saam bos toe gaan, waar hulle baljaar en in die bome rondswaai. As daar besoekers by Chimpunji is, kry hulle die kans om saam met die chimpansees bos toe te gaan. Het is een wonderlijke ervaring om te zien hoe die dieren leer boomklim en die veld ontdek. Die bezoeker zelf moet ook maar bond staan om die klomp te vermaak. Sabu is die grootste van die groep en ook die parmantigste van die lot. Hy het glo die bijnaam Joburg Thug gekry, omdat hy so 'n bullebak is. Dit lyk asof hy homself as die dominante een van die groep wil vestig. Hy geniet het om die kleintjies te karnuffel as hy nie sy sin kan kry nie, maar hy het blykbaar nog 'n sagte plekkie vir Violet. Alhoewel Violet nog redelijk klein is, het sy blykbaar heel wat verander vandat sy uit Johannesburg weg is. Sy is glo vol lewe en haar vel het goed herstel na die uitslag wat sy gehad het. Sy het nog steeds daardie kenmerkende stappie, amper asof die swaaiende arm haar aanhelp om vinniger te loop. Dit gebeur baie dat sy agterraak as hulle in die bos gaan loop en dan sal Sabu elke nou en dan vir haar wag, haar 'n drukkie gee en aanhelp, net soos wat hy gedoen het toe hulle nog in die Johannesburg dieretuin was. Violet het goed gekonfyt geraak met die boomklimmery, maar as die boomstamme te dik is en haar arms te kort, sukkel sy maar. Sy bly ook nog onderlangs in die bome, want die geronswaaiery is 'n tegniek wat 'n sjimpansee wat nie in die natuur groot geword het nie, nie sommer oornag aanleer nie. Sabu aan die ander kant lyk weer of hy dink hy is die kampioen takswaaier. Die veluitslag wat Violet gehad het toe sy by Shimfunsi aangekom het, het ongelukkig na al 5 die kleintjies versprei. Dok het glo die ergste gelyk en vandag nog kan 'n mens sien dat sy vel nog nie heeltemal herstel het nie. Die 24ste April van jaar is die kleintjies uit hul tydelike hok langs die huis geskuif na 'n groter stuk grond. Billy Joe, die seekoei wat elke aand op 'n bank langs die hok geslaap het, het die dag toe die kleintjies verskuif is, blykbaar aangevoel dat iets nie reg is nie. Hy het geweier om terug te gaan na sy hok toe en die hele dag agter Sheila aangeloop. Toe sy die aand vir die kleintjies by hulle nuwe hok gaan kos gee, het hy verstaan wat aangaan. Hy het by die hok gaan staan en hulle het een vir een aan hom kom vat. Eers daarna het hy tot rus gekom. Die lewe op Shimfunsi is altyd opwindend en soms ook onvoorspelbaar, maar altyd kleurvol.
Dit lyk of dit goed gaan met die tweetjies. Die sukses van Dave en Sheila Siddle se werk op Shimfunsi is 'n aanduiding van die belangrike werk wat hulle doen en wys ook die behoefte wat daar vir so 'n oord bestaan. Till next time, take care.